So ladies and gentlemen, at TED, we talk a lot about leadership and how to make a movement. So let's watch a movement happen, start to finish, in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons from it. First, of course you know, a leader needs the guts to stand out and be ridiculed. But what he's doing is so easy to follow. So here's his first follower with a crucial role. He's going to show everyone else how to follow. Now notice that the leader embraces him as an equal. So now it's not about the leader anymore, it's about them, plural. Now there he is calling to his friends. Now if you notice that the first follower is actually an underestimated form of leadership in itself. It takes guts to stand out like that. The first follower is what transforms a lone nut into a leader. And here comes a second follower. Now it's not a lone nut, it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd, and a crowd is news. So a movement must be public. It's important to show not just the leader, but the followers, because you find that new followers emulate the followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, and immediately after, three more people. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point. Now we've got a movement. So notice that as more people join in, it's less risky. So those that were sitting on the fence before now have no reason not to. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, but they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. So over the next minute, you'll see all of the those that prefer to stick with the crowd, because eventually they would be ridiculed for not joining in. And that's how you make a movement. But let's recap some lessons from this. So first, if you are the type, like the shirtless dancing guy, that is standing alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals. So it's clearly about the movement, not you. Okay, but we might have missed the real lesson here. The biggest lesson, if you noticed, did you catch it? Is that leadership is over-glorified. That yes, it was the shirtless guy was first, and he'll get all the credit, but it was really the first follower that transformed the lone nut into a leader. So as we're told that we should all be leaders, that would be really ineffective. If you really care about starting a movement, have the courage to follow and show others how to follow. And when you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first one to stand up and join in. And what a perfect place to do that, TED. Thanks.
current and future movement builders. I'll just add a few things at the end. How does that sound? Yeah, okay.
Sounds great.
Great, thank you. So I started my first social enterprise in my living room in New York City when I was 26 years old. I had been working in South Africa for 2 years in the post-apartheid era. So Nelson Mandela was elected in, elected in 1995, and I arrived in South Africa in 1997, and I lived there for 2 years. And the work that I was doing in South Africa was working with a not-for-profit organization who for many years had been working with unemployed black South Africans who had flooded in from the rural areas into the cities looking for work, and who ended up settling and living and making their lives in these very overcrowded slums around the big cities that are referred to as townships. And the work that this NGO had been doing for a long time was teaching adults basic business skills, and then also teaching them a trade like leather tanning or hairdressing, kind of trades work that people could use to start a very basic micro enterprise. And at the time that I started working with this NGO, they were also, I think, tired, like feeling frustrated at only being able to make a small dent in equipping unemployed adults to be able to earn an income, you know, enough to feed their families, send their kids to school. So they decided they wanted to seize the moment with this, in this post-apartheid era where there was a lot of changes in the education system being made, to bring entrepreneurship education into the school system so that children, whether they needed to or wanted to, be able to start a business to generate their own revenue in the future, that they would be better equipped to do that. So they would never become destitute at all. And so during that time, I worked both doing basic business skills training with unemployed adults in the township, and I also was part of a team that developed hands-on, very experiential learning curriculum that could go into overcrowded classrooms and undertrained teachers and still perform and do that work of making sure that South African youth were getting prepared to be able to secure their livelihoods. So during the course of that work, something that I learned was that what my real gift was, that I had no idea because I'd been working as an advertising executive in Toronto selling Dove soap before I went to South Africa. So I had no idea that my real gift and calling was actually to develop experiential learning training and to teach people basic business skills and to have them have light bulbs go off in their heads to realize that even though they may not have had a good education, and even though they might be semi-literate just because they had had a terrible education, if any at all, that they could learn skills that allowed them to earn more money the next day and the next day and the next day, which gave people greater self-efficacy and more control over their life. So I decided that I wanted to make this my life's vocation. So having never worked in the international development or economic development industry, I thought the UN was going to be my partner in this endeavor. So I moved to New York City and I started a business in my living room, or really like my bedroom, because my living room and bedroom was kind of the same room. So, and
you know what that's like.
You know what that's like. Maybe some of you have businesses happening in your bedrooms at the moment too. And I started a small company. It took me 16 years to ever get a contract with the UN. So woohoo, 16 years later I worked with the UN. But what I did learn in the intervening years was how the international development, the US-based international development industry worked, of who my partners could be, which was a lot of international NGOs like CARE and Save the Children and SLAN and Catholic Youth Services, and that I could do work for the US Overseas Development Arm, which is called USAID, and the US State Department. That these were the kinds of organizations that wanted to do work in emerging economies and developing countries, helping people gain those skills. Okay, so for 10 years, I did that work. I had clients who would hire me and my growing staff to go to developing countries and train, sort of what I've been doing in South Africa, to train teachers, to train local trainers, to train microfinance institutions on how to impart these kinds of basic business skills to low-income people. And over time, we got recognized as being a trusted partner, like, oh, you kind of work with Fiona and her company, like, they'll deliver. So people began to ask us to do more and more in the economic development industry. So to do a whole bunch of different things, but we still had that DNA of feeling that people were capable of incredible things, given the opportunity, and that local organizations serving low-income people were also capable of incredible things, but they often just needed capacity. They needed to know more. They needed to be taught skills. They needed to have good materials put in their hands. So over a period of 10 years, I did work with thousands of organizations across 40 different countries. And most of the organizations that we worked with, like we would work with, for example, in Senegal, we worked with about 80% of the microfinance institutions in Senegal. They were giving microloans to women, but they wanted to make sure that the women also had basic business skills so they could run more successful businesses, make more money with those loans. So most of the work that we did was with adult-serving organizations like that. And it had always, and we did a little bit of work in the youth entrepreneurship, youth workforce development sector. Workforce development is like wanting to have schools that are teaching skills to young people that are supposed to lead to jobs, to make sure that young people are actually learning skills that do lead to jobs, so that those precious resources of time and money that families are investing in young people to be able to eventually earn money, that that doesn't get wasted. Because to support a child when you've got very little money to be in school through to the time that they're 12, 14, 16, 18, and then have them graduate and not be able to earn money is devastating to those families. So a lot of the work we did with adults was very well organized, and the sector was very developed. So I was based here in D.C., and me and my colleagues would go to developing countries and build capacity in local institutions. And there was a lot of NGOs, not-for-profits doing that work, for-profit consulting firms, individual consultants, universities, a lot of groups doing that work. And that sector was really well organized. Like, you could go to a conference almost every week in America on how to do this better, working with these adults. But what I observed was that for organizations like ourselves and all those organizations, we're doing little pockets of work with young people. Like, was it appropriate to give young people a bank loan that they would have to repay? Was it appropriate to give that pressure on them? Or did they really need savings accounts, not loans? What would be the best way to reform an education system to make sure that it wasn't just one or two schools teaching skills to young people that would make them employable? How could you transform a whole school system? We didn't have the right opportunities to go and learn from people. So that means, for example, I might be implementing a project in Bolivia, and someone had done the same kind of project in Jordan 2 years earlier that had been a flop. And I was about to make the same mistake in my work and repeat that flop over again. So a lot of us were wasting money and wasting time and wasting the opportunity for young people to be able to get what they needed for them and their families to get ahead economically. So I was sort of observing this, and for about 2 years, I went around muttering to people, like to my six-person staff, like, why isn't the World Bank, like, doing convenings around youth economic opportunities? Like, why isn't USAID putting money into a research agenda? Why aren't the donors, like, organizing themselves so they can have a common research agenda? Like, 2 years of going around muttering about how, like, somebody should do this. So one hot tip I want to offer you is that if you find yourself like I did, like you're thinking about a problem all the time and you're really like worked up about why no one is doing something about it, that can be a strong signal that you are the person to do something about it. Like if it's really keeping you up at night, you're like talking a lot about it to people. And this is something that in the entrepreneurship sector gets said. Like, is there something keeping you up at night? Do you think someone should do something about it? Like, you just keep saying that to people, it's like driving you nuts and them nuts. It could be you. So I got that push to do something about it when I got selected to enter like a business competition for women entrepreneurs in America. And basically, in that pitch competition, you had to say what it is that you wanted to do. Like, what were you going to do with the prize money? What were you going to do with the support? And like, how are you going to scale your business? And I just found myself blurting out, like, I'm going to convene for people working on youth economic opportunities. And the judges were like, great, so why aren't you doing that? And I was like, I don't know, I'm like waiting for somebody else to do that. And they were like, well, what do you need to do that? And I was like, I need to hire a manager to like basically organize this convening. And then they were like, okay, we're giving you this like award so you can go out and do that. And so 1 week later, I drafted a job description, I posted it, and in a month, I had hired that person. So for me, that's just like a learning there about the kick in the pants, and also the vote of confidence that you sometimes need to take a big leap. So fast forward 10 years later, and what had started as like just like a one-time conference, conference I wanted to do had grown into the largest sustained network of donors, foundations, consultants, not-for-profits, for-profits, academic institutions, coming together at one annual point every year physically, but also engaging in a lot of exchange through webinars and so on. And I think you may have read the article that Mike circulated that kind of talked about some of the achievements. And so I, through this movement, I was credited with really accelerating the caliber and the volume of resources that was going to support youth economic opportunities globally. So out of that, like tens of more millions of dollars were allocated by the U.S. government towards youth economic development. It was realized, wow, like youth need to be treated differently than adults do. Wow, we've now like seen that the evidence base shows that if you support youth in these certain ways, you can get exponentially greater results than if you support them in other ways. So that's kind of how I got started and a little bit of like where we ended up after 10 years. So I welcome any comments or questions that you have. And if you have your own experiences to draw on, I would love you to bring that in as well.
When you first started your annual convening, like, how did you get so many people to show up, or like who was your first like follower, like they said in this TED Talk?
Thank you for that question. So I want to let you know that I was gripped with debilitating fear at times that it was going to be me and like 30 people, basically the people who I'd convinced to be on the advisory committee, sitting in a ballroom at a big hotel in D.C., and that I would be $100,000 in debt. Because in order to make the business model work, we needed to raise sponsorship money, but we also needed people to pay to register. So we ended up with that first year having 237 people from 35 countries. And so I love your question. So how about the first people? So the first thing that I did was go to people who I admired. I think I admired for like what I perceived to be their commitment to really doing youth development right. And I asked them to be on the advisory committee. And every person and every organization said yes. 10 years, every organization I asked to be on the advisory committee said yes, except for one. I won't talk about them. I won't name names, but I will talk about them. And so these people, you know, I love what Seth Godin wrote in The Tribes, right? He wrote something here about saying, like, keeping it small, and like, try and be everything to everyone. And what I would say is, another way to look at that is build the coalition of the willing. Because the coalition of the willing are people who are doing it like they're because they want to be there. They want to be there. And even though they have their day jobs, right, and people are very busy in this town, they are choosing on top of whatever it is that they're supposed to be doing that day to like give time to this movement that you're behind. So the way that I did that was the advisory committee. I wanted people to have a designation. I wanted a committee of people who I could go to on a regular basis and like say, this is what I'm thinking about for the theme. Like, who do you recommend as sponsors who we can raise money from? Hey, will you give some money to this event? And the advisory committee is a strategy that I've used numerous times since then. And I think it is, the advisory committee offers you benefits, three major advantages. One is that an advisory committee offers you valuable guidance. So at this stage, I started my company at 26. I think I started doing this convening, the youth economic development movement building at 36. So, okay, I've had like 10 years in the industry, but that's different from 10 or that's different from 15 or 20. And also because I started my business at 26, I was like young, right? I'm only 36. So most of my peers were not like CEOs of companies. My peers were junior analysts. Like my peers were not powerful people. But one of the great things about being president, CEO, executive director is you get to call up other presidents, CEOs, executive directors, even if they are like making five times more in salary, they have five times more experience, and like they've got 5 or 50 times the number of staff. So I was able to leverage that to reach out to influential people because I needed their advice and guidance. So it wasn't just window dressing, like I really went to them. The second benefit that these first followers offered me was credibility. So what had debilitated me, I think, for those 2 years, like why I'd been muttering, like someone should start this movement, was because I felt many of the emotions that are talked about here. Like I felt, what were people going to say? I was afraid that people were going to say, like, who does Fiona McCauley think she is of her little, you know, not a little social enterprise to be doing this big, important activity? So, and there were people who said that. But I felt stronger because I had these influential CEOs and vice presidents and directors on my advisory committee. And other people were like, oh, like that influential person from the World Bank is like got the picture on the website, right? You want to be very visible to the advisory committee.
Pictures on the website, logos.
Pictures on the website. Oh, they're like tweeting about this event, right? So that coming from me, third-party validation is also very important, but when you get third-party validation from influencers, that really helps you a lot. So real advice, that they would be influencers. And also that they did help with like opening doors to other things that I did.
Thanks
for your question.
When you're building your team of people around you, what qualities do you look for in your team members?
So I think that's a great question. So I treated this like a startup. So I had one startup, right, that after like a lot of trial and error had gained a lot of traction and was sort of moving into the like millions in annual revenues. But this was a startup, so it had a new business model. Right? The business model was very much through like raising sponsorship and getting grant money and people registering. The topic was different. Like before, I had people who knew how to do the planning, delivery, and evaluation of global development projects, and now I need people with expertise in convening and communications. So, in fact, the person who really I consider my partner, like my co-founding partner, was someone who was very entrepreneurial herself. She was, and I credit her, she was that person in the video who like made that activity take off. And she was entrepreneurial in that she was comfortable with risk, in that she was comfortable with pivots. You know, we would like be pivoting 2, 3, 4, 20 times a week based on what we learned about who was interested in sponsoring, who wasn't, if this theme was relevant to people or not. So she was like very comfortable, and she was really a thought partner for me. And I, that movement that we developed around kind of building the evidence base for youth economic opportunities and investing in that sector was really due to me and her and the advisory committee, like, and the people who said, hey, I want to come and speak at your conference for free, and all these other people who we brought, and it really was a circus, but with big tent, which we called it the big tent approach. So we invited a lot of people in, and we gave them a lot of credit. So for example, we gave a huge visibility to the speakers who were speaking at our event. They brought us credibility, they brought us good content. We also realized for them to continue to be giving up their time the way that they were, often, you know, using their capital, social capital at work to get money, or reaching into their own pocket to like pay for travel, that we needed to make sure that there was a real win for them, that they not only felt like they were contributing to the movement, but they were getting visibility for their work, and they deserved it. And so one thing I'll tell you is that with the sort of second movement that I'm building now, which is around building greater numbers of women leading in the global development sector and diverse leadership, specifically people of color moving into greater leadership opportunities, is that we just announced our agenda yesterday morning. So we announced our 55 speakers who are going to be speaking. And now one of my team members is creating social media graphics with the photograph, the headshot of each of those people and the name of their talk that they're giving. And we will put out that across our social media. We'll roll that out over the next 6 weeks. We will also send those social media graphics to those people so they can promote their participation. Because, again, like this upcoming convening around women's leadership would only be happening with them contributing. And, right, all that credibility that's going to be afforded to the event because they're participating.
I'll piggyback and answer that question too. Like, what do you look for in team members? I found it's good to look for diversity in all areas except for values. Mm-hmm. Finding individuals who share the same values and certainly a level of integrity and trust in there. Like, are they going to do the right thing when you're not looking. And there's like a story, like somebody on a job interview goes out to lunch, and you know, when the waiter isn't looking, he like takes an extra roll or something without paying for it. Well, guess what? If you're gonna do that on a job interview of all places, like I bet you're gonna put some other things in your pocket when the boss isn't looking. So making sure that the people you attract to your team are trustworthy, you know, are gonna do the right thing even when no one's looking. I think diversity in perspective and skills and background and age, gender, all those things can make for stronger teams rather than, you know, everybody just thinking the same way and always doing the same thing.
Yeah, 100%. Thank you for the talk. I have a question. How did you end up with Georgetown?
Georgetown?
Yeah. So, so the consulting firm that I started at like 26, I ran for, you know, I was a CEO for 18 years. Mm-hmm. And then the Youth Economic Opportunities Movement that I started 10, like, well, now 12 years ago, but I led that for 10 years. And then I got to a point where I felt like I had made my greatest contribution. Like the consulting firm was thriving, the forum was like thriving, and I felt like I had like done what I had to do. And so I sold the for-profit, I passed on the not-for-profit, and I thought what I really want to do is foster entrepreneurs and social entrepreneurs. And so the questions I asked myself, I was like, okay, how are leading universities and incubators doing that? What materials do they teach? Like, because I know the heart of every good program is also like a methodology. Like, what are they teaching? Like, what are the materials? Like, how are they teaching it? How do I get good at that? And who's doing it? And so I basically answered those questions by talking to a lot of people. I went to some training courses. I like went on websites. I kind of, you know, went to different events to see what was going on. And I was like, oh, I think that entrepreneur in residence role at Georgetown would fit what I am like seeking to do. Mm-hmm. And by that time, I guess over since when I sold the company for like 8 months, I'd just been in learning mode. And I kind of came to realize like, wow, like a lot of the people who are actually teaching these kinds of content, like customer discovery and startup, they actually haven't even taken the classes, I've been taking the courses. Like I've been taking it from the people who wrote the book on this. Like I went and got trained by Alex Osterwalder on business model canvas. I got like trained by Ash Moray on like lean startup. And I was like, wow, I am actually overprepared for this job. And then I was like fortunate to be able to get that designation and like meet people like Mike, yeah. Who I am like learning from every month.
And likewise, I learned from her and all the other EIRs. This is my fourth year as an entrepreneur in residence, and I've always been the youngest kid in the room. And it's been super insightful to, you know, and humbling to be with all these other very successful entrepreneurs who build all these amazing things. And, you know, I started doing it because I had a sunglass company and I liked being at Georgetown on Tuesdays. And, you know, it's been a really, I think, powerful community and folks that all, like, we have the same values. You know, like what's important on a team, like, we value teaching social entrepreneurship, finding opportunities to engage with students and, you know, share our experiences.
Yeah, I like sharing materials. Like, I've had has passed on like some great teaching materials to me, and I don't know if I've reciprocated yet, but I hope I can.
Well, you're doing it right now.
Okay, awesome, thank you.
Have you ever had a time when you had to make a drastic change in your plans, and if so, how did you know that you needed to make that change?
Like make a drastic change? So I know that I have. I just have to like think about that. And I'm wondering why it's not jumping to my mind is like maybe because I just like it was so terrible I blocked it out. But I'll tell you one thing that so when I made that transition 2 years ago, I was really looking forward to it because I feel like I had for like 18 years carried a pretty significant load of responsibility. And like sort of, you know, I'd say for me maybe a significant load of like just ever present anxiety, like just those like, you know, people, I had people working in Afghanistan, I had employees who didn't work out, I had like cash flow bridging, right? We have like you have a lot of money coming in from invoices, so people are late paying, so now like you don't have enough money to pay people. And so I was like super excited to like sort of be able to put all that responsibility, just have that not be on my shoulders anymore. And sort of have this freedom to like go out and learn new things and spend time with new people. And I remember like the day after I signed the papers and the company was sold. And I was like, well, now I'm going to do it myself.
because for 18 years I had really had a singular focus on something that had to do with one aspect of the company or another. And so it probably like took a couple months to really settle in to that new freedom and to settle into new networks and to settle into that new mode.
If you could go back and give advice to the person you were at 26 years old creating this consulting firm, what would you tell them?
I would say ask for help. Mm-hmm. Okay, ask. I wish that I had asked for more help.
Oh, yeah.
What kind of help? What's a constructive way of asking someone for help? As you've now, I think, gotten pretty good at asking people for help.
Yeah. Oh, I'm like asking people for help all of the time. And I feel like that is... And it's also just like a reflection of like, wow, should have done that sooner. So when I was 26, and I had, as I said, finished my undergrad at university. I thought I wanted to be an advertising executive. I had a like early 20s professional life crisis when I realized I'm actually very good at selling Dove soap, but like I don't want my boss's job. And I don't want my boss's job. I was like, ah. So I ended up in South Africa. I thought I was going to go for 4 months. I stayed for 2 years. And then I had this drive that this was like the calling that I needed to do around getting these experiential learning training materials at the hands of adult and youth educators. And I felt like, and so I showed up in New York, and I didn't know anyone in the global development industry. I didn't know how to run a business. I'd never taken a business class. And I mean, it's like a miracle in America. To start a business, you just like call a 1-800 number. It takes 2 minutes on the phone, and you get something called an EIN number, which now allows you to open a bank account, and it's how you pay taxes. So later in life, some of the work that my company did is we did work in some countries to make the business registration process easier. So like in Armenia, it takes 46 steps to like register a business, 3 months. Just as an example. And I always... My benchmark when we were doing that work was always like, how can we move Armenia from where they are to like being in America where like any idiot can just like register a business in 2 minutes over the phone. Okay, but I digress. Okay, so this is how tall I am. I'm wearing heels. So this is like me on a tall day. And I think I have a little bit of a baby face. I'm assured, no, I really do look my age now. But when I started my business, I felt like very inexperienced. I felt very physically small, and I felt very female. And when I started my company in New York, this was in 1999, and this was in the web like boom era. And so New York was filled with entrepreneurs and wannabe entrepreneurs. And I couldn't go to Central Park without like meeting someone who had a tech business. Right? And they were like, everyone was like, had tech businesses, they were raising all this money, they were like, gonna be exponential growth. And my big claim to fame is that you didn't even need electricity for my product to work. You know, and I was like, what? Like, what am I doing here? I'm completely outclassed. So my response to that is that I needed to, like, show up and be perfect. So I don't know, I think that article that Mike might have circulated about perfectionism. Basically, perfectionism is insecurity in high heels, right? It's like all dressed up as something very polished, but it wasn't. What it meant for me is that I felt like I didn't ask for help in for how to run my business, for like how to find employees, for how to find the clients, for like, you name it, like I didn't ask for help about it. The one thing that I realized I completely knew nothing about was like how to set up a basic bookkeeping system. I couldn't perfectionist my way out of that. I was like, oh my, I don't know. So I did ask for help. And you know what? Someone's like, yeah, well, I have got a small business. I've got an accountant. He set me up with her. And like, thank goodness. Like, I always had perfect books from day one. Well, like maybe like day 30 because I was like desperate. And I think as time went by, as I built more confidence, and came to know what I knew. Like there were some things I just knew. Like, I know how to develop experiential learning training materials. You know, like, I know how to do marketing. That I was like, I could really own that I knew how to do that, and that I learned how to ask for help with confidence. And especially as a startup entrepreneur innovator, right, you were like wearing so many hats that there's no way any one person could be expected to do it. So I would say, like, ask for help and do it with confidence.
Yeah. Sacrifice quick question. This is also why our classmates are taking their accounting exams right now, so they can help you with your books later on.
Keep in touch with those people.
Yeah, exactly.
So I was actually going to ask, like, who should we ask for help? Are you thinking, like, friends, like, family, anybody that you can, or is there, like, somebody, like, some umbrella of individuals that you can ask, like, that are not necessarily related to you, but that can help, like, in some way?
Yeah, well, I think all of the above. All of the above. I would say never hire your friends and family. It's like too rife with issues for all the obvious reasons. But if you, for example, if you're like looking to raise money, either because you're actually looking for like a low interest or no interest loan, or you're looking for a grant, or you're in a situation where you're looking for investment money, then those are the kinds of things, both how to do that, I think you can ask for help, and I think if there's like a good contact for someone who might want to offer those things to you, I think you can feel confident doing that. And one of the things that the research shows is that particularly women are more comfortable asking for help when it's like in service of something or somebody else. So women, I'm not saying that that applies to all of us in the room, but I'm just saying the research shows that women can have a harder time like negotiating or making asks when it's for themselves. But they are as effective, if not more effective, than their male counterparts when they're doing it on behalf of something or someone else. And I just think that's like useful to know. And so sometimes I think a conversation you have with yourself is reminding yourself what you are doing this in service of. Because if you're a social innovator, you are doing this in service of something and somebody else. And so it can like help with your mindset. Like, I'm gonna just, no holds barred, like, you know, whatever your cause is, like, I'm doing this so that infant mortality is decreased. I'm like doing this because I care about animal rights. Like, I'm doing this because I care about increasing the kind of food waste that gets composted.
I do a lot of things at HealthSend because I'm getting resources for social entrepreneurs. Like, I don't mind asking anybody to come over and like give their expertise or time or meet with these fellows. I'm not saying, hey, give us all your money, but you're really smart and you know a bunch of smart people. I'd also encourage you, Zach, to think about not just your friends and family, people you know, who are people like way up there, and you're not going to get all of them, but if you reach out to 10 or let's say 20 folks, maybe 6 of them respond to you, maybe 3 or 4 of them will actually have a meeting with you. And as somebody who does get asked for things now from a fair amount of people, like in that ask, if you can be specific and say, one, you know, hey, Mike, I really want to talk to you. I appreciate your experience as an entrepreneur and running this program, yada, yada, yada. Stroke a little bit of the ego on the front end, tell them you look up to them, and say, hey, I'm working on this project to do this, and I have 2 very specific questions I'd love to ask you, and email them the questions. People email me questions, even if I don't want to meet with them and get coffee for half an hour, which is often not an efficient use of time. I can spend 2 minutes and type up some responses and give you some feedback and maybe send you a link somewhere. Like, make it easy for them to help. Don't ever say the words, can I pick your brain?
What?
Well, people will be like, hey, can I meet with you? I just want to pick your brain. What sane human wants their brain picked at? Like, that's not really a good way of phrasing it. You say, hey, you know, I'm a Georgetown student. That's another card you can pull. People like to help students. I'm a Georgetown student doing a research project, doing customer discovery, you know, on a new concept. Would love 15 minutes of your time just to ask you a few questions and see, you know, how you can help direct our product development. Your input is really valuable. Thanks. That's, I think, a pretty good way to ask for something.
Yeah. I would say almost like no matter how high you reach up, if you follow that guidelines about this, about authentic flattery, specificity, and sort of the why, you're more than 50% going to get a reply. And I would say sometimes LinkedIn can be a good way to do that. For some reason you can get higher response rates on LinkedIn. But also email, if you send that email and then you're like, oh, I never heard back from, you know, Jane Smith, and like, probably is not interested. You know what, Jane Smith just sent too many emails. So by all means, send it again, but just keep it short. Be like, dear Miss Smith, wanted to put this in the copyright box. And you can definitely do that like 2 or 3 times before you're like, I'm not getting an answer.
Very politically correct, just moving this back up to the top of your inbox. You're not judging them for not responding, maybe they didn't see it. Well, they're going to see it again, and you just, you know, reply so they can see, hey, this is the 4th time this person's followed up.
Yeah.
They're politely persistent.
Yeah. It's a gift.
Yes, it is.
All right, I'm just going to glance at my notes to see if there's anything in particular. Oh, yeah, back to the coalition of the willing. So you asked that question, like, thank you. So I talked about the advisory committee, and just also one of the things when you're trying to get something new off the ground, I think a movement, a social enterprise, an idea. activity is like, for in order for people to help you or to join your movement or to follow you, they have to know you're doing it. So that's like a very scary moment between conceptualizing your idea, deciding you're doing it, and then like putting the word out, right? It's like, what if people don't like the idea? What if people criticize you for it? What if they think, who are you? Of course, you have to put the word out so people like know that you're doing it. So that's just like a big, you just like gotta do it. Do it in a way that feels comfortable for you. Do it in a way that feels safe for you. And then the coalition of the willing is the tribe that you will first build. And I also want to talk about the coalition of the positive peer pressure. There will also be important people, influential people, or just numbers of people that you attract who, for whom this may not be their pain point or passion point, but who are smart to realize when you need to strategically join in. And that comes once the coalition of the willing gains significant influence or size. Right? Like, again, love what they said in the video. Like, so many people are joining because they don't want to be on the outside. And if that's okay, I advise you to just welcome them with the same open arms as the people who that you welcome the coalition of the willing. And sometimes, I mean, I'll speak for myself. Initially, when I was doing the Youth Economic Opportunities Sector Growing Initiative, I felt a bit resentful to those people. Remember, I said every organization accepted to be on the advisory committee for 10 years except for one. Well, for 4 years, we first did that convening, actually at GW University's conference center. And then the Inter-American Development Bank, the IDB, invited us, like warmly invited us, really wanted us to do that event at their conference center because youth development was becoming a priority for them. It was like a gift to them that we could come in with this kind of pre-built, well-branded event, and they provided the venue and they got all the kind of reflected benefit from that. I appreciated that. It was a great win-win on both sides. Great partnership. Well, this group had always said no. The IDB was a big funder of theirs. So when the IDB invited us, like it was like, couldn't believe who was calling me on the phone, like saying, hey, we want to get involved. We want to be on the advisory committee. And, you know, my first reaction was, you know, you can imagine, like in my head, I was like. And then, you know, I was like, strategically, it makes sense for me to involve them. In fact, I will be better serving the youth population to involve them and welcome them. And I did, and they played a useful role. They were like another validator of the event. They never gave us any money, but all right, they like registered people to attend, and they supported, you know, their involvement probably brought other people into the coalition of the women. So I just wanted to mention those people.
And what you're looking at, one other movement building attribute I think is necessary is creating calls to action for people to take, as well as giving them easily shareable content, media, especially in today's social media age. Mm-hmm. Instead of saying, you know, hey, write a social media post about what we're doing and tell your friends about it, what I actually encourage people to do is to literally write the social media post in your voice and then say, hey, copy and paste this and hit post. And there's a way on the internet to just have a click to tweet where you literally write the tweets with the hashtag and the tags you want, and they click it, they push enter once, and their work is done. That two-button pushing is a significant lower ask than saying, use your creative brain, articulate what the heck it is that we're doing that you probably don't know too much about, and tell your friends about it. So like with Waveborn, as we built our movement and had kind of a tribe of followers, and if it wasn't clear, by the way, I was the first follower. I didn't start Waveborn. I was that second guy. I was like, oh, that dancing shirtless guy, I want to hang out with him, Jonathan. That's awesome. I bought a pair of sunglasses on the website and emailed getinvolved@waveborn.com. And I was like, hey, this looks awesome. You know, I'm a computer science master student here at Georgetown. Like, what can I do to help? Like, I want to join the movement. And I had no idea the company had started a month earlier. There was only one person, the founder, in it, and that he lived 10 minutes away in DuPont Circle. So, like, all this happened because I was willing to go and kind of look like a fool with this person who had a cool sunglasses company. And over time, I realized, as the first follower, I have to show other people how to follow. And as we got to our crowdfunding campaign, we had, like, a shared Google sheet with probably 10 different Facebook posts and like 7 different tweets that I shared with everybody who backed the campaign. I had all these people commit on day one that they were going to back it. We raised $10,000 in less than 36 hours because I spent 3 months telling everybody I'd ever met about it, getting a lot of people be like, no, I'm not interested, and the coalition of the willing be like, yeah, I'll definitely back it for $50.
you know, give me some photos, some stuff I can post on social media. I'll tell this group from undergrad or this group at my church or my coworkers, whatever it is. So finding people that join your tribe, they also are usually members of other tribes. And the message that you share in those meetings and those interactions in that classroom can then leave the room. And any good storyteller tells a story that ideally leaves the room and you can go and tell other people about it. I think that word of mouth marketing is ideally free and is how you're able to spread these ideas, and especially with the internet and YouTube and TED Talks and all this other stuff, like things can spread much, 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 much faster than like the old, you know, literal tribes like having to go walk over nomadically to their neighbors and tell them about a new berry recipe or something.
Right on. That's very true. No, that's very true. And actually, you know, as I mentioned, my communications team member will be sending out social media graphics to everybody. And every week she sends 2 pre-prepared tweets, pre-prepared graphics out to all the communications contacts at our partner organizations. And just makes it easy. Just makes it easy for them to get the word out. So just the final thing that I wanted to share, because I think this is like a useful takeaway, connects back to a point that Mike said at the beginning about the importance of having consistent culture between your team members. And Seth Godin writes about kind of faith versus religion. And I would say, as the leader of the movement, well, it is not about you, and so much of the time your success will come from giving empowerment and latitude and credit to people who are either on your team or part of the coalition of the willing. You are the keeper of the values. You are the keeper of the values. And that is something that you have to take very seriously and keep front of mind with everything that you're doing. So having your values written on a sticky note, or having them painted on your wall, or having them on a flip chart, whatever it is, and being something that you come back to with your team and with your coalition consistently is something that's going to help you make better, consistent decisions, and it's going to help all of the people who might be paid on your staff or volunteers on your staff and the coalition of the willing to follow the culture that you're setting. Because if you get something off the ground to the point that you have even that first follower, it means you are doing something very right and very important, and that you've already established something about a culture that people want to be part of. So that is your number one job.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Fiona, so much for joining us today. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Happy to be here.
Yeah. And class, good job getting everyone got their 10 ideas in for this week. Folks taking your accounting exam, I hope you do well on the exam. Watch the video. We'll see you next week. We're going to do business model canvases. And the links to read and everything are in there. And I'll follow up by Thursday. I should get this video up for everybody.